Sebelumnya thank you buat Ko Vincent sama Mbak Devi juga acara sebelumnya. Udah capek-capek bikin acara undang kita gitu ya. Dan juga teman-teman sekalian. Wow, many people, right? Oh sini ya, oke. Sebelumnya aku mau tahu dulu dong, kira-kira di sini yang came in from engineering background, like software engineers, ada? Design, working on design, UX researcher, UI UX design, oke. Unfortunately kita gak ngebahas itu dulu. Tapi tenang, ada makanan gratis dari teman-teman Tokopedia. Kita sekarang lagi mau ngomong tentang more into product management, right? So, who's from product? Okay. Kayaknya saya gak salah ngomong gitu. So, let's go to the slide. So, I wanna start this talk with one single question. Who is product owner and manager? Or product manager? Some part of the company say it's a product manager, some part say it's product owner. So I wanna throw these questions to you guys. Right? Sebenarnya apa sih product owner? Kalian bisa jawab? Lo product manager? Kita ngapain gitu ya? No? Meetings, right? So, typically, you know, on very agile environment, biasanya kan, ya, halo, teman-teman yang di startup metodologinya agile ya, agile. Role-nya itu product owner ada di tengah antara customer sama engineering team, ya. Yeah. We talk with the customer, try to understand what's your pain point, what's your problem. We try to solve it. Terus deliver to engineering team. Terus ada satpamnya gitu ya, si scrum master. Just to make sure that we are delivering things in right process. Terus datang customer complaint, muncul customer support. Ada. Kita ngomongin yang tadi barusan ya, acquisition, retention, marketing growth. Terakhir ada business owner, tiba-tiba datang, besok kita mau ada event sama partner kita, bisa nggak deliver produk. Meanwhile, our customer itu ngobrol sama kompetitor. So, it's not simple anymore, jadi product manager atau product owner yang tadinya kita cuma ngomongin pain points ataupun ya, personas, empathy. Sekarang kita mesti ngomong in different language, in growth language with marketing team, in the business language. Ini mereka drill down ke like 200 product persons dan nanya sebenarnya pain point dari kalian apa sih? Karena kan product owner selalu ngomongnya pain point dari customer ya. Sebenarnya nggak ada yang nanyain pain point kita ya. Akhirnya ada yang nanyain pain point kalian apa sih? So, they try to map, dari 0 sampai 9. Kalau 0 itu kalian ngerasa kurang banget waktunya. 5 itu pas lah, enough. 9 itu terlalu berlebihan. Ternyata masing-masing product owner atau manager itu ngerasa terlalu banyak berlebihan waktunya di navigating internal politics. You know? Because we are managing many stakeholders. Mulai dari marketing, mulai dari business owner and everything else. Karena kita jadi kayak gateway ke engineering team. Dia engineering team marah-marah, kenapa besok? Gitu ya. Poin kedua, kita selalu ngerasa karena gue terlalu too much spending times in internal things, kita kurang running product experiments, kurang crafting the roadmap itself. Then you know, like Ko Vincent previously talked about, product management You know, it's very very hands-on experience. Karena, you know, most of the time we're dealing with people, not only about customers but also internal stakeholders. So this is the thing that I want to talk about. The reason why I choose anti-pattern. Jadi backgroundnya itu kalau di software engineering itu ada software design pattern, kayak object oriented dan lain-lain. I try to reuse the terms of software pattern itu basically sebuah pola yang dipakai sama engineering team buat kalau kita nge-build sesuatu itu lebih gampang. It's very efficient. Kayak misalkan reusability, pakai komponen yang udah ada, bikin yang baru. Okay, do not reinvent the wheel. Anti-pattern itu kebalikannya. Dan inilah kenapa saya ngerasa kita mesti ngobrol hal ini. Kenapa? Karena dari sisi product management, kita mesti belajar sebenarnya anti-pattern kita apa. What is our downfall? What is things that kita sering ngomong, ya udahlah kerjain dulu. Tapi sebenarnya gak bagus. So, the first anti-pattern that I want to talk about itu product sama dengan proxy. Right? There's very, you know, very good quote by Michael Porter, Harvard professor. Basically, he told that, you know, the very essence of strategy is saying no. So that's what the thing that we need to talk about. Right. So the first pattern, itu biasanya ya, kalau kita ngomongin product management, marketing, growth, business owner, itu pasti langsung datang ke produk yang kita butuh ini, gitu ya. Terus dari si product ownernya karena yang masuk banyak requestnya, terus kita mesti mikirin yang buat ada di next sprint minggu ini, udah masukin aja. Terus kita nggak validate customer, you know, voice, kita nggak lihat dari sisi value mana yang lebih deliver business impact. Dan akhirnya kita write stories is a write spec. Kita nggak ngasih background ke engineering team kalau what is the purpose behind of this improvement. Kita nggak ngasih business background to technical leads. Sebenarnya kita butuh apa? Kenapa itu matters? Karena kalau kalian kasih tahu reasonnya, people will think further. Solusinya bisa beda. Dan bahkan how you solve this thing together will be different. So, growth cost, itu ada juga another survey, basically. Rata-rata dari ini yang survey itu high level management role. Mereka melihat kayak product managers are technical, not strategic roles. Sorry. Dan kedua, product managers are not able to influence engineering or management effectively. So this is a set route that we need to learn and improve. Right, so how do we need to solve this? I quote that from Beatles, all you need is love. And it's unrelated, by the way. But, you know, anyway. Jadi, kalau kalian adalah si kepala product owner atau product management, sorry, itu cuma ada dua hal yang biasanya dipikirin. Effort, kayak tadi kita obrolin, sama value. Jadi kalau mau nyari pacar, jangan nyari pacar product manager. Karena pasti nanyanya effortnya seberapa gede, returnnya berapa gede. Nah, kita biasanya mapping. Jadi ada dua kalau dibagi ya. Ada medianya misalkan dari effort, ini standar solution kita. Terus kalau dari customer value itu juga ada medianya berapa. Terus kita bisa bagi jadi empat. Ada yang quick-quick. Itu low effort, tadi udah sempat dibahas sama Mbak Devi, tapi high value. Ada juga yang long term, high effort, high value. Ada juga yang short term. Dan ada juga yang kita gak boleh kesitu, kayak very low, low value dan big effort. Nah, pattern yang pertama sebenarnya apa sih? Contoh kita ada tiga feature gitu, voucher, discount, terus ada pop-up banner at home, sama ada targeted notification. Biasanya nih yang ada di product owner yang kejadian gak cuma di tim saya juga dan di kebanyakan kejadian itu kita selalu melihat, oh oke, okay, if there's too much unknown, kita cenderung milih we go this route, gitu ya. Kita pilih kerjain, oh yang lakuin dulu, baru ke short term solution, baru ke long term. Dan di situ kita pilih MVP release-nya, oh ini release-nya cuma bisa ini aja, voucher sama discount. So short term sama quick win. So this is an anti pattern. Kenapa? Not saying this is a, you know, giving negative values, no. But is it bad practice? Why? Kita terlalu melihat yang gede nih karena prosesnya, karena feature-nya gede, too much unknown. Jadinya dari kita malas. Dan kita terlalu sering mikir, oh ini karena gede, yaudah, it's easier to negotiate to engineers. Kalau kita pilih yang lebih gampang. Terus juga lebih easier waktu kita ngomong ke business person, karena kita langsung bilang, oh ini bisa jadi, instant gratification. Kenapa? Yang harusnya kita lakuin, menurut saya, gitu ya, we should split, right? We should break down the unknowns and see, you know, what is the real effort for this and what is the first phase or first release or first version. Jadi kita mesti rajin-rajin tuh untuk ngebaginya. Jangan langsung ditinggalin dulu. Kenapa? This is because this deliver high value. Then this is what I want to talk about basically. Minimum lovable product. So it's not only viable, right? It doesn't, you know, means that we need to do things that it's really really low effort, but it should be lovable to the customer. Dan di situ adalah value utama kita sebagai product owner. We understand the customer and deliver love. Right? That's why there's Beatles there. Okay. Yeah. Terus kedua, anti pattern yang saya juga mau obrolin itu lebih ke arah. So when we talk about product, it's not only about effort versus benefit anymore. So it's also about funnel. Biasanya kalau di orang produk pasti ngomong funnel. Awalnya itu user masuk dari mana? Oh dari install. Habis itu ke registration, explore, order, sampai ujungnya the action that become our goals, right? This is the transaction. Typically, you know, since you have like the other side, not only engineering but also the business and growth, they talk with different language, right? Dari business mereka ngomongnya what is the profit, what is the ROI. Dari marketing growth juga pasti ngomongnya question sama retention. Dan di sini ada anti pattern, tadi sempat ada pertanyaan menarik untuk GMV. Kenapa nggak diukur GMV-nya? Kenapa kita nggak melihat itu sebagai metric? It's very interesting question actually. Dan di DANA itu sendiri, personally ya, dari saya, melihat it's a vanity metrics. What does it mean by vanity? You know, it's a thing that very very shiny. And you're very proud to wear it or to show it to others, but basically it's distracting. Kenapa? Let's say ada transaksi bulan ini kita nge-deliver like maybe 1 trillion, right? But there's only maybe like 100,000 transaction numbers. The real value, right, of that engagement with the user is not about the profit. It's not about how big you get the return. Tapi seberapa banyak, kalau dari sisi product management ya, kita membuat user love our product by doing it like intensely. Kayak transaction numbers matters, right? GMV depends on the business, but I would rather not go to that route. Kenapa? It's distracting you. Active sessions, it's also for me, it's anti pattern. Kenapa? session doesn't mean anything. Terus kalau misalkan orang buka app, terus mereka disable lagi, buat apa? So we need to align this metrics with the business team. Why? Because in the end, your product will use the same KPI or OKR or something to measure its success. Which means your roadmap will be defined by this metric. Jadi kalau dari awalnya metriknya udah beda sama tim bisnis, biasanya tuh panjang tuh belakangnya. Ya. Dan disinilah tugas kalian sebagai product owner or product manager validate those metrics. Because maybe from the very start it's a wrong metric. Not wrong, but this metric. So transacting users, so we use transacting users instead of only active users because we doesn't want user to only active. We monitor the transaction. Even kalau numbersnya itu kecil ya, kita active session kita misalkan 1,000, tapi transacting, you know, like maybe 10. Proud with those 10 instead of proud with those 1,000. Kenapa? It's the real thing that you guys get a real transacting users. Transacting user, transacting number, referral biasanya. We use those metric. Kenapa? Kalau orang suka sama produk kalian pasti dia merekomendasikan. You can get the referral from using your referral promo codes, or you generate you're extracting from kayak misalkan survey or any kind of customer feedback yang misalkan Play Store bisa dicek juga. But this is basically a numbers of love, right? For check numbers. Kalau kita ngeliat user nggak suka, itu pasti mereka pergi. Ini juga mesti kita lihat kenapa churn user is the truth. How many user, how many people leave your product or doesn't want to use your app anymore is basically the truth that you need to fix. So this is the second vanity metrics. So the third one that I want to talk about. It's about the product meaning proxy itself. So that's a very, very distracting or inefficient pattern that we see. Kenapa? Biasanya it will leave the product team as only someone who passes the requirement. And it's, you know, if you take away the decision making from product to decide the priority, you won't deliver the values and basically you won't bring much anymore into the strategy itself. Biasanya kita ngomongin ada dua hal kalau kita untuk ngomong solve produk sama dengan proxy. Biasanya kita kalau di DANA kita juga pertama kita planning. Ini kayak ini misalkan produk feature apa aja yang mau kita kerjain, terus kita map kira-kira berapa banyak hours dari engineers yang dibutuhin. And it's a very usable data, jangan di remove, jangan di nggak dipakai lagi. Dan kedua, kayak tadi Mbak Devi bilang, basically return, like in terms of funnel, berapa banyak transaction numbers yang kita generate, terus itu kita convert ya in terms of the value of the business itself, in terms of tangible values, not the money. Beberapa dari teman-teman dulu di internalnya nanya, Mas, tapi nggak semua feature bisa ngasilin transaction. Terus gimana ngukur ROI-nya? Well, even for example like you want to measure explore feature, it still reside within the layer of the funnel itself, right? Jadi walaupun dia nggak langsung berpengaruh terhadap transaksi, dia ada impact. Kalau misalkan let's imagine exploring funnel kalian itu cuma 70% conversion rate-nya gitu ya. It will also impact to the transaction itself. So you should measure this using some way mechanism. Kalau kita biasanya dibagi, jadi bilang ya ROI di estimate untuk priority di awal, tapi itu juga tetap mesti kita lakuin di akhir. Kenapa? As a friendly reminder to the team that we love them, right? So this is the better product sama dengan proxy, bring the ROI. Right. So anti-pattern nomor 2 yang mau sebenarnya gue obrolin adalah, kalau pertama kan lebih how to manage internal stakeholders, this is the anti-pattern that we found when dealing with external customers, external stakeholders, which is the user itself. So anti-pattern nomor 1 itu waktu kita jalanin dengan terapkan, right, empathy, kita jalanin design sprint, dan ternyata ada beberapa anti-pattern yang kita temuin. Pertama itu selection bias. Kenapa? Karena kalian gak bisa ngambil seluruh user kalian untuk di usability test, ya kan? It will be a random sampling or some selection, which is the persona itself, right? And persona, every persona that you choose will have different background, dan itu bakalan influence decision kalian. So you must understand about this loophole. It doesn't mean that design sprint or design thinking is perfect. It also has some of the loophole. So how we solve this? Biasanya kita roll out di stages, gitu ya. Jadi kita coba validate using A/B test and try to see the real data from broader perspective. Tapi kita mesti tes. Kita mesti coba bagi lagi ke masing-masing some part of it. Right. Terus yang pattern number 2 yang kita temuin juga dari teman-teman produk di DANA waktu itu, we tend to love what we invested with. Kebanyakan product owner yang udah emotionally invested di product feature mereka dan udah banyak banget, kayak gue denger gini udah panjang lah ceritanya, udah versi ke 100, lo cenderung untuk keep it as it is. Padahal kita selalu harus mengevaluasi ini produk masih jalan apa enggak. Ada sebuah metode which is di intercom feature audit, kita bagi jadi dua. Ke kanan itu how many people use it, like the fraction of the users, the numbers. Ke bawah itu dia ke frekuensinya. Dan kita mesti bedain, kalau misalkan dia di nomor 3, very little of the time and very few customer use it, you need to decide that you might need to kill it. It might doesn't work the effort anymore. Jangan karena kita udah investing too much, akhirnya kita gak berani make that decision. So that's the anti-factor, the sunk cost bias. Kenapa? Karena kita udah spending too much on this. This is like pacaran actually. Lu terlalu lama pacaran sama ini padahal berantem mulu, udah, terlanjutin. Right. Next, it's the more bias. Basically, I'd like to point out that our knowledge is limited. We have what is known unknown. Apa yang kita tahu, kita tahu. We also have what known unknown. Kita tahu kalau kita nggak tahu. Kita tahu kalau kita nggak tahu caranya bikin roket. Kita tahu kalau kita nggak tahu caranya bikin electric car. Okay. But we know, we understand. It's part of our limitation. Dan terkadang ada juga unknown unknown. Kita benar-benar nggak tahu kalau kita nggak tahu ngapain itu. That's where bias come from, right? So this is the part where kalau beberapa kali kita ngadain usability test, ada interview bias dari teman-teman product owner misalkan di DANA, secara nggak langsung mereka baru di daerah user. Sini. Ujungnya sukses semua. Gitu. Terus ada confirmation bias, kita nunggu, oh ini desain gue yang ini udah cakep nih. Kayak ini pasti yang ini. Waktu reportnya datang, oh iya benar-benar yang lain gak diperhatiin, gitu ya. Dan juga ada reporting bias. We need to hear the bad news, not only the good news. Beberapa bad news mungkin dihilangin dari desain yang kita pengen plan to implement. That's also the anti pattern. So how we solve it together, right? Biasanya kalau misalkan kita interview usability test, pasti ada yang main person yang interview, biasanya satu orang. So not to make them afraid or disturb. Yang lain pasti di ruangan terpisah dengerin, tapi kasih tahu kalau misalkan mereka bias. Dari sisi survei juga itu mesti divalidasi, karena takutnya QMA-nya kayak jawaban-jawabannya udah, oh ini cenderung ke salah satu action yang kita mesti yang si product owners want to achieve. Dan in the end, we need other person to validate unknown unknown. So, I also like to point out basically in regards to having another person work us together, then we need to also be aware, right? This is the truth, girls, right? Your solution, the things that you build, is not perfect. You do not understand your customer fully, right? And you may misidentify the problem scope itself, right? That's the truth, girl, that you need to understand. And by accepting this, you will start your growth mindset. You need to know that there is a limit of what you know, and you will start to grow, right? To learn. So that's it, what I'm talking about, right? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Rangga. Okay, so let's jump into the Q&A session. So I think we have some questions on Slido. Can we check? There's one from a username GoNigger, interesting name. So the question is, why should we use DANA over GoPay, PayPro, or interesting question. It seems there are a lot of alternatives.
Okay. Okay, that's very interesting. It will be a bias, right? Because I already explained you the anti-pattern. Jadi kalau dari saya sendiri sih, so it's all about unique selling proposition, agree. Dari DANA kita coba dari awal itu we try to be open. We try to be open platform. How? Kita itu pertama mulai di BBR, Bukalapak, dan juga other merchants. Why? Because we want to have an ecosystem. Why DANA? Right? In the end, or GoPay or OVO, it's about adoption. Whether you have enough merchants and enough use case to do your payments. Because payment is two ways, right? Lu bakalan ngomongin duitnya itu bisa di duit yang gua taruh di balance ataupun aset yang gua taruh itu bakal bisa dipakai di merchant apa enggak. So why DANA? Because we will have many exciting merchants later on. Jadi kalau ngomongin merchant kita bakalan ada nanti bakalan like in this month there will be some exciting news. Second is we also very very focused to our user. So if you guys have any feedback to us, we will listen. Part of the how we deliver the user experience, for example, right? How we focus on user experience. Kita fokus di saat yang lain pada fokus di. Jadi kalau PR kan ada dua metodenya. Si scan B, customer nge-scan business. Jadi depan ada QR sticker, lu scan, right? Atau B scan C. B scan C itu kita punya PR, kita tap di device, selesai. Kenapa kita fokus ke B scan C? Contohnya ya, ini as part of our focus to user experience. Waktu lu si scan B, lu ada dependensi ke internet connection di handphone lu. Otomatis contoh lu mau bayar QR tapi di parkiran sinyalnya susah, gitu ya. Lu mau bayar QR di rural area sih bisa. That's why we develop B scan C model. Itu untuk jadi kita udah ngetes by the way. B scan C kita bisa cuma like 3 seconds if the condition is normal, like and then that configuration and things. Dan kita implement smarter ways to challenge the user to keep it safe for the security. Jadi kalau di DANA itu kalian mungkin nggak sadar kalau sebenarnya awal-awal kalian diminta PIN buat beli pulsa. Udah 2 atau 3, 4 transaksi nggak diminta PIN lagi. Kenapa? Karena kita ada risk engine-nya. So we detect the pattern and build what we call trust relationship. Jadi kalau user ini udah sering transaksi dengan amount segini, amountnya kecil, itu kita bakalan bikin dia lebih nyaman dengan nggak ngasih PIN. Tapi kalau kalian pakai account yang sama terus tiba-tiba di luar negeri ada pakai account yang sama, mereka bisa kena challenge PIN, terus bisa kena challenge OTP. So we try to make it easier for the user while at the same time we put more security measurements. Itu satu. Kedua, kita nggak cuma ngomongin kalau misalkan e-money as a balance, tapi kita juga ada party walletnya. Orang bisa nge-save kartu kredit, kartu debit di Dana and do like every transactions seamlessly. Biscansi model, jadi kalian bisa tangan ramayana udah ikut kartu kredit tap ataupun di KFC. But again, the very core value, to be honest, if the decision whether Dana or GoPay or OVO will dominate the market is the merchant adoption, right? You won't use if you cannot use it on other merchants, right? Let's be honest, something like that. But in terms of product, I believe we are small. We start like maybe in March, so it's about 9 months. But we have hungry for knowledge. We listen and we learn, right? And that's why you will use that.